Ladies and gentlemen of the EPW, my name is Tanner McDavid, and this is the Elimination Chamber recap. So, it's a few days after the Elimination Chamber. Here to talk about the matches, and about the pay-per-view itself, but there's something I kind of have to address concerning the EPW World Heavyweight Championship. If you haven't seen the video, the reaction video, the winner of the pay-per-view was great. All right, Derrick, where are you at? Come on out.
EPW World Heavyweight SmackDown Champion from the Epps Authority, Derrick Epps. It's so good to be champ, baby.
Yeah. Woo! Well, Derrick, I actually have to be honest here. I have to congratulate you on your first win, my friend.
It's about time.
About time. 9 months!
9 months.
Got 9 months ever since I started this thing.
I finally got one.
Good lord.
I was confident on my picks. I stuck with them, and Bray Wyatt got me home.
Yeah, I figured he would win, but we're actually going to talk about the pay-per-view now.
Yeah, let's talk about the Elimination Chamber.
Start off with Mickey James and Becky Lynch. The storyline going in overall was decent. I kind of like the idea of having the older veteran resenting the newer generation of wrestlers coming in and kind of forgetting mm-hmm. about them, even though they haven't really forgot about them. But to be honest, I really appreciated the storyline, seeing Mickey James back.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, it was definitely good to see her. I just wasn't impressed with her in the ring. I was really looking for her to do some more than she did.
Yeah, no,
Becky dominated. I hate to say that, but...
Didn't really see a lot of vintage Mickey James. I was ready for her to like come out, be all crazy and everything like she was, and
you know, maybe they're saving it for Mania.
Maybe
who knows? I don't know. But Becky Lynch ran away with that one. The crowd was behind her, and then it was a kickoff match. It wasn't great, but
it was still decent. It was kind of really obvious who was going to win that one. Becky.
Yeah, if I had to give it a grade, let's give these match grades. I'd give it like a B minus.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe even a C plus.
Yes,
right in the mid tier. It's okay. Kick her off. Yeah. What was next?
The next one was the handicap match: Apollo Crews and Kalisto versus Dolph Ziggler, which was real, which was really weird. Two baby faces ganging up and on a lone heel.
Yeah, what they're doing with Ziggler now is they're trying to make him heel, but he was a much better face.
He was,
I don't know.
I don't know. To be honest, I kind of like the storyline they're going with. Give us other people that we can actually care about babyface-wise. Well, we don't give a crap about Apollo Crews, which I wish they would do something with, but right now we just don't care about him.
He's got all kind of talent.
He does, and then Kalisto, honestly, nobody really cares about him a lot either. So if you're going to give him this storyline, put him up against people that we actually care about, and then we will be invested.
Yeah. Maybe they can do something with this Apollo Crews, Dolph Ziggler thing. I could see that one-on-one for a while.
Now that one I would actually be impressed with. I think it was the whole fact of adding Kalisto into the mix. He's kind of molded over.
What they did, I think Dolph had allegedly beat up Kalisto backstage.
Mm-hmm. So No, it wasn't backstage. It was whenever Kalisto was about to come out, then they brought him back out.
On the runway. Yeah. So, it was Apollo versus Dolph for a while, and then Kalisto came in and did some moves, and they ended up doing
really that. No selling the injury that he first came down to the ramp with. He acted like he was hurt then all of a sudden whenever he came in. Nope, forgot about that, and started no selling his injuries.
That match was not great either.
I'd give that a C-.
Yeah, mine's a D+, so not moving up. Moving on.
Next match was, this is the fun one. Nikki Bella versus Natalya.
I'm going to give my grade first. I honestly, I don't do this often. This match was an F. It was an F for me. I'm going to tell you why, Tanner. Okay. I'm going to tell you why it was an F. All right. These two, right now, nothing's happening between them. They're irrelevant in the women's title hunt. Nikki's on her way out. Her neck, I think WrestleMania is it for her, honestly.
Really?
I think so. Her neck has never really recovered. Natalya is just the veteran there. And just the whole fighting of them, getting back at her getting against Nikki because she's with John Cena. I never liked the storyline. But let's put that aside. The match itself was awful. It was an awful match. They treated it as if one of them had the women's title. And that, because, you know, usually a women's match, they'll be maybe two or three almost pinfalls, and then they'll get it. This one had 7 to 8 near pinfalls.
And like, then the submissions also.
And they had lots of submissions, the sharpshooters, and then she did the STF, Nikki did. And it was, by the end, we were all wishing that one of them would tap out, and the crowd was dead. The crowd was, they weren't cheering, booing. It was just too long. And then it ended on a double count out, which is the worst ending of all time. So I give it an F because as soon as it started, they did nothing to grab my attention, and then it got worse as it went on, and then it ended in a double count-out, so that's an F for me.
Honestly, looking back at it, I don't think my reaction to it during the thing was really just. I actually give it a C.
Okay.
Here's my reasoning. Honestly, the storyline itself, I understand where they're coming with, but the storyline was based off of Total Divas, Total Bellas.
Right.
That sort of thing. It was based off of the reality shows, which automatically brings it down for me.
Right.
Make it in-ring, and that's... It was a technically sound match, and it honestly had great heat towards it because they'd been at each other's throats.
Right.
And it's still culminating, even on SmackDown now. But, honestly, it did last too long. It did feel like a title match, even though it wasn't. The double count on finish, I wasn't disappointed in
it. You saw it coming. They were way far away.
Honestly, I saw it coming.
He was at 8. I was like, that's it.
No, you even hear me. It's like, whenever it says 5, I was like, it's going to be that count out. Double count out.
Right.
But it makes sense, to be honest. Because I don't feel like this feud is done yet.
Maybe so.
It makes sense, but... In the heat of the moment, I was just ready for it to be done. But looking back at it, honestly, I don't think it was as bad as we made it.
Maybe I could bump it up to a D minus. You know, F is bad. F is bad. Maybe a D minus. We'll go with that instead of the F. Mm-hmm. But thankfully, we can move on from that.
Yeah. next one was actually starting the good matches. Luke Harper versus Randy Orton.
Luke Harper. Let me say this about Luke Harper. He can wrestle anyone they have.
Yeah.
I believe that.
He works well with just about anybody.
He does so good in ring. He's a former Intercontinental Champion. People forget that. But while he was away from the Wyatt family for a while. But him and Randy in the ring was really great. I really enjoyed this match.
I'd give this one a B+. Had a few missteps. Had a few moments where I felt like... It kind of felt slow. But
yeah, Luke never hit his turnaround clothesline.
No, it didn't hit the crap, what is it called?
He spins and it's like a
discus clothesline.
Discus clothesline, That would have made it a little more interesting. I'll give it a B+ too, because it was at that point in the pay-per-view, it was the best thing that had happened. So we were all pretty pumped.
And the reason why I bring it down also is because it was really obvious who was gonna win.
Oh yeah.
Randy's obvious.
Randy's gonna win, yeah, but I still, even if I knew from the start that Luke Harper was wrestling somebody going to lose, I'd still watch. I love watching Luke Harper.
It makes it really entertaining, and I like the storyline going on with him breaking off away from the Wyatt family right now.
That match B+ for me.
B+.
So the next match was the women's title match?
Yeah, women's title match, Naomi versus Alexa Bliss. Yeah. And what a shocker!
Yeah, really.
Honestly, I did not see it, but after what you said, it makes sense.
See, I didn't reveal this information before because I didn't want anybody's picks this way. I did some research on some different wrestling websites, and here's one site picked Naomi, and I was really confused. I was like, Alexa is, you know...
She's really hot right now, and I figured they wanted to keep the momentum going into WrestleMania.
But here's what it said about Naomi. WrestleMania is in Orlando. Naomi is from Orlando. Also, last weekend, they released a new clothing line for Naomi on WWEshop.com. And those were two signs that these people said maybe she's going to win, maybe, and give her a title shot. And I had originally picked Naomi, and I switched. I was just like, well, I knew the belt was going to change hands in the Elimination Chamber. Mm-hmm. So I said, they'll probably keep the belt on Alexa Bliss. But they didn't. And I was shocked. And it was a pretty good match.
It really was a good match.
It's in the B. It's in the B minus, B plus.
Honestly, it felt a little too short, to be honest.
If it had switched places, if it could have been what happened with Nikki and Natalya,
it would have been great.
Yeah, it would have been a great match.
Bumped it up more, but yeah, it's around B minus for me, just because of the shortness of it. But it bumps it up really big for the swerve that WWE put on us there, because I did not see that.
And I think it's good. Naomi is a fantastic wrestler.
Oh, she's been with the company for so many years, and she's been a really great worker, done pretty much everything they asked her.
She has, like, the glow right now. It's kind of cool.
Honestly, that it's been her better storyline. They finally got her storyline going with her.
Maybe they can work in some kind of triple threat at WrestleMania between her, Becky Lynch, and Alexa, because those are the top three, I think, on SmackDown. Yeah, so that's a B in the B range for me. Mm-hmm. We skipped a match. We skipped the tag team turmoil.
We did skip the tag team turmoil.
We can talk about it right now.
Yeah.
About halfway through was this thing called tag team turmoil, where it was sort of like Royal Rumble with tag teams. It started with two teams, and when one was eliminated, a new one would enter.
Yeah.
And so, it started with the champions, American Alpha.
No, it didn't start with them. It started with Heath and Rhino and Breezango.
Right. And then Heath and Rhino eliminated a couple teams.
They eliminated Breezango, and they eliminated the
Vaudevillains.
And honestly, like you said, I feel like the Vaudevillains, they need a little more push.
They're not going to get it.
I know they're not, because Vince McMahon does not like them.
No, they don't. And when they were on NXT, I really loved their entrance, and they could really do something with them, but they're just going to, have their own house show city, honestly.
They're
going to stay there. But I picked American Alpha
because
I was confused. I didn't know who to pick because it's sort of they're the champion, but the playing field is very even.
It really is.
It's not that, and I'm not saying it's bad. I like a lot of the tag teams in SmackDown, but there's no. It's not like the New Day on the Raw or even Luke Gallows and Anderson.
Yeah.
It's just there's not much discrepancy in the talent. Everybody's above average.
Yeah, I really feel like
so. I just picked Alpha to retain, and they did, thankfully.
Yeah, thankfully.
But I'll tell you, I'm going to give this match an A-, honestly.
The Turmoil match?
Yeah,
that one was an A for
it was
me.
Good.
A-.
The big thing coming out of this was a rivalry between the Usos and American Alpha.
And that one is going to be cultivating more on SmackDown Live.
Absolutely.
I have a feeling that they're going to be fighting at WrestleMania, unless they've changed it.
Yeah, I think the Usos are still made of a quality tag team. I'm not really into the whole
Thug
Punk thing. I like the Samoan thing better, but it works better as a heel.
It does.
And what happened was American Alpha eliminated them, correct?
Yeah, and then...
And then the Usos super kicked them 20 times and, like, did all their finishing moves on and left.
Yeah.
And the only team left remaining was the Ascension.
And that honestly scared me for a minute.
Oh, we were all like, there's no way that the Ascension can come in here and win. Because they are the most ridiculous thing. I said I like all the tag teams except the Ascension. And here's why. I'm not saying they're bad wrestlers, but their gimmick is like the Road Warriors.
It's the Illuminati.
They're like Road Warriors wannabes. But they're not near as big. Maybe I just need to watch some matches to see if they can wrestle.
I've watched them a little bit. They can wrestle. They actually have something going with them. I think I've looked past that, them trying to
be the Road Warriors. They started the weird face paint thing.
I like that. That makes them a little more unique than the old face paint. That made them look like the Road Warriors.
I didn't want them as my SmackDown tag champs.
Well, I hear you.
And when they came down and American Alpha was laid out, I was like, please, no. I was like, just pull a superhero. And American Alpha... That was my first time watching a full-length pay-per-view match with them. They performed really well.
They do. They perform really well. I watched SmackDown.
They're like little Kurt Angle Juniors.
I know, and I wish they would do something with Angle with them.
Maybe they'll do a rest. Maybe they can do some on
maybe,
SmackDown.
Maybe. But here we go to the final match, the Elimination Chamber match. And right off the bat, I'm giving this an A.
Hey.
Right off the bat, that's an A.
Very good match.
Great match. Honestly... And
it smacked the Royal Rumble.
It did. It totally just...
totally smacked
it. Here's the Royal Rumble. This is the Elimination Chamber.
Boom.
Out of there.
Smacked it home.
Oh my gosh, it was so good. Honestly, I figured Bray Wyatt was going to win, but the way the picks were, I had to do something in order to make sure that I was going to be in there in contention.
Right.
And Honestly, it was a smart decision. It was actually a smart
pick.
It came
down, he picked AJ, of course. And it came down to Brandon AJ.
Yeah, so I figured, it's like, oh my gosh, maybe.
I knew.
Glimmer of hope.
Jeff Hutchins told me. I had my pick deal. He said, Bray's going home with it. He saw my picks, and he's like, Derek's going home with the title tonight because of Bray.
Yeah, honestly, I did think Bray was going to win. I honestly did think that, but I wanted to do something to where maybe throw a curveball out there. Just maybe I can sneak in there. But
yeah, I'm really glad he has the title. I think he deserves it. His character has stayed strong. You know, usually he's been this character, what, 3 years now, maybe?
3 years now, yeah.
And the people still love it. Mm-hmm. They still turn on their flashlights. They stay with anytime his little thing comes on with the promo and he says, we're here, people go nuts. And to see that stay that way for 3 years, obviously when they first came out, I was like, oh, these guys are weird. This is cool.
Yeah.
But now and it's really just about him now.
It really is.
He's got the other guys, but it's all about Bray Wyatt.
Mm-hmm.
And to see him have a title and be like that, I really like it. And he can wrestle. The guy can wrestle really well.
He really can.
You know who his grandpa is? Blackjack Mulligan.
Okay.
So he's got the pedigree, and he's...
It's a good thing, because he's actually came up to the main roster before, and I'm glad he overcame it. You remember,
Husky Harris.
Yeah, Husky Harris. I was about to say that.
Yep.
I'm glad he overcame that.
Right.
But overall, it also helped set up some matches for WrestleMania.
Yeah, the Intercontinental title.
Dean Ambrose and Baron Corbin. Mm-hmm. And honestly, I feel like me and Derek were discussing this. I feel like Baron Corbin should get the title.
This match was great for Baron Corbin for me. I was not a Baron Corbin fan. I called him Roman Reigns Jr.
Mm-hmm.
because he's got long hair and just not on steroids. But this match for me, he did a lot of good things, I thought,
mm-hmm.
and kind of showed me his individual assets. And I really like his move, the End of Days. He did that several times.
It's a reverse rock bottom.
Yeah,
I like that.
He ended up beating the crap out of Dean Ambrose because Dean eliminated him. And then Baron proceeded to beat the crap out of him. And then The Miz came in and got a cheap
pin. And that's what Baron Corbin's known for.
It looks like, and on SmackDown last night, they had a button of heads.
Yeah, I like that. I'm glad they're doing something with Baron, because for the longest time, all they really did with him was the Andre Memorial Battle Royal.
Yeah.
But honestly, I was a fan of him coming in. He has something good going on.
I'm excited to see where he goes now. I'm going to say I like it. But mm-hmm. I liked watching him that night. I think he will be a good Intercontinental Champion because Dean Ambrose...
And that's boring with it.
Is not... Yes, he's not... compared to The Miz, who flaunts it in their faces and wears it like a trophy, which, mm-hmm. as it should be, the Intercontinental Championship is one of the most prestigious they have and the best looking.
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody in the EPW will agree that it is the best looking.
Yes.
And The Miz... treated it like a piece of gold, and Dean Ambrose kind of just drags it around.
Yeah.
And he hasn't defended it.
Kind of reminds me of Roman Reigns with the US title.
He hasn't defended it this year. And I'm not saying it's a knock on Dean. Dean just doesn't need one. He's kind of like Roddy Piper. You don't remember Roddy Piper for being a champion. You remember him for being,
the crazy son of a gun that he was.
Right, and that's Dean Ambrose. You know, he's the Ambrose Asylum is what he'll be remembered for. So giving it to Baron at WrestleMania, that could be a really good match.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't be upset with that.
Another match coming up that you even mentioned, and I do see it now happening, mixed tag team match, John Cena and Nikki Bella versus Miz and Maurice.
That's right.
Honestly, I feel like that's going to be a good one, and it might set up a rivalry between Cena and the Miz again.
Yep.
Back in 2009, I believe.
At WrestleMania
they fought. It was kind of mad because... You know, Miz really wasn't that big of a talent. Now he is a bigger
He's
name.
He's the best heel in WWE.
He is, honestly.
The Miz.
Well, some would argue Kevin Owens on that.
Well, as far as just running your mouth and tearing people down, I like KO. The KO show is great, but The Miz rocks.
And I like the rivalry going on with him and Daniel Bryan right now.
Oh yeah. We're really hoping that maybe somehow Daniel Bryan gets to wrestle one more time.
Wrestle at WrestleMania against The Miz, but that's not going to happen.
You know, maybe we'll go nuts.
Yeah, but if he comes out and wrestles, you will see me lose it.
So let's do overall grades for the whole paper and kind of average together.
Okay.
So we had I had a D minus and a couple C's, mm-hmm. had two A's and a B. So I'm going to say that averages out to like a B. If this is a grade, it's probably like an 86. For me,
just a lackluster mid before the final.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I give it a half grade. It's going to be a C for me.
C, mm-hmm. That's close. The highlights were good,
mm-hmm.
but the lowlights were bad.
Yeah.
So, but we're coming up on Fastlane in a couple weeks. Got some new stuff coming up.
Got the Raw title.
Raw title's on the line. New storylines. We could talk another hour about that.
Yeah.
Chris Jericho, Kevin Owens. Things happening.
Yeah. So let me just say this. Jordan Roten, you may claim that there's this new you and how you're standing on your own feet. I've been doing that since the beginning, my friend. I've won that championship that you have around your waist twice. You're going to see a three-time champion. Raw is where I dominate. Raw is where I make the best picks.
It's true. Tanner's a Raw guy.
So let me just say this, Jordan. Your time as EPW Raw Champion is going to be coming to an end.
And as far as the Raw goes, I'm clearly a SmackDown champion. I'm super pumped to have the World Heavyweight title. News coming on that. Epps Authority's got its first title. But there is someone else in the Epps Authority who can complete the circle. Jordy, Kevin Owens.
Okay, out of kayfabe, dude. No. The way he has been picking.
He has been picking awful.
He has been picking awful. He is Jordy, not winning that title.
But Jordy's going to come around. And I hope that he can win the Raw title, and then the Epps Authority will have almost total control in the EPW.
He won't do it.
All I got to say is, it's good to be champ, y'all. Thanks for watching. This is the EPW Elimination Chamber Wrap-Up Show.
See you all next time.